गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। कैन यू लुक, कैन यू सी माय स्क्रीन?
यस।
ओके, गुड।
यस सर।
या, गुड मॉर्निंग। सो इन आवर लास्ट क्लास वी वर डिस्कसिंग अबाउट हाउ वी कैन प्लेस द पोल्स एंड द जीरोज इन द एस प्लेन, right? And from there, from the positioning of the poles, position of the poles and the zeros, we can try to find out what is the transfer function. Okay, and we have seen that at a particular frequency the modulus or the amplitude response of the system is given by bn multiplied by bn, where it is a frequency independent gain. Okay, so bn is the frequency independent gain multiplied by multiplication of the distance of the zeros to that particular frequency, and then that is being multiplied, okay, divided by the product of the distance of the poles to that particular frequency. Okay, similarly we can find out the phase response at that frequency by summing up the zero angles to p minus sum of pole angles to p, and for that we have found out how we can do it over here, right? So initially what we discuss is that this transfer function, it can be represented into this equation, say equation A, okay, and from there we can get the amplitude response and the phase response. So when we talk about this point P, if you go to our previous point, previous diagram, the P over here is anywhere on the H plane, but we are interested only on the frequency axis, which is the imaginary axis. We are just available over here. So what happens is that we start from zero, and then we go to, say it is, if it is P0, then we go to P1, then we go to P2, and so on till we reach P infinity. So what are these P? These P are nothing but, they provide information about the analog frequency. Okay, do you have any doubt over here? Anyone has any doubt?
Yes.
I hope everything is clear for all of you up to this, right? Now let's move on to the next topic, not the topic, next slide. Now let's see how the placement of the poles, or how the poles, they affect the amplitude response and the phase response. Over here, let us take one case where we have a one pole or pole only. System. And this is basically a single pole system. So when we place a pole on the left hand side, there will be another conjugate pole which we need to place to make the system realizable. Okay, so if you want to place one pole, that means in practicality you have to place two poles. Okay, so what it will do, so the first pole, wherever you want to place the pole, it will be put over there, and consequently there will be another conjugate pole which will be automatically placed or you should place over there. Okay, so that is by default. If you place one pole somewhere, you need to place another conjugate pole to realize the system. Now, if you go back over here, if you see, suppose we have taken one pole over here and we are discussing that we want one six effect, or we want to find the distance between this pole and the P point, right? Now, if you come over here, so what is basically happening? We have discussed that we are basically interested on the frequency axis. Now, this is the frequency axis, this imaginary axis is the frequency axis. Okay. Now, let us take this j omega point as the point P. Okay. Now, if you try to draw the or find out the amplitude response modulus of HS of this system, what you will be having? We are considering that Bn equals to 1 at this moment. Okay. Now, what should you get? You should get, there are no zeros, so we will be having 1. And there are two poles. Say the distance of this pole P1 to the point P is d, and the other pole P1 dash, okay, why I have put dash, because it is a conjugate pole of the P1, right? Over here the distance of this pole to the point P is d dash. So from our last classes information, we can say that modulus of HS is equal to D multiplied by D dash. Okay, D multiplied by D dash. However, if you see the effect of this pole on the positive half of the frequencies, you will find that it is having a minimal effect. Okay. Why minimal effect? Because if you consider 1 by d dash, if you see at any particular frequency except at this point 0, the length of d dash, or you can say the d dash value will be greater than d value, right? Because all the positive frequencies, it will be closer to this pole. Now, what would happen? So, if d dash is greater, then what will happen to the 1 by d dash? It will be smaller. Okay. So, under practical considerations, what we do is that we do not use the information about the conjugate pole to estimate the amplitude response or the frequency phase response of the filter. Okay. Now, coming to this single pole only now. Now, what would happen if you compare the phase response over here, this amplitude response, sorry. If you compare this amplitude response, what you will be having? Can you tell me? The thing is that if you look over here, sorry, say this distance d1 or d0 you say, so because at zero frequency we are looking into the effect, so d0 will be greater than, say at this point we have d1, okay, will be greater than say this d2. Up to what point? Up to j omega naught point. Now this j omega naught point, this is called the resonating point. So what happens in the case of resonance? In the case of resonance, some of the effect, it becomes the highest. Okay. So in this case, for this pole, this is the resonating point, because at this j omega naught, say if the distance is d3, it would be the smallest distance. This distance which I am drawing and I am marking with blue, this distance would be the smallest distance. Okay. And if you remember HS modulus, at this point 1 by d3, d3 is the smallest, so this should be HS modulus of HS, it would be having a maximum value. Am I clear? So at this point I am be having maximum value. Now if I go beyond this, say d4, again it will be greater than d4 will be greater than d3. If I again go to d4, d5 say another, so d5 will be greater than this thing, and so on. And as we go towards the d infinity, it will be much greater. This d infinity will be much greater. So if d infinity is much greater, this value modulus of HS, it would become much smaller. So if you see this b this modulus of HS response, so what is happening at zero? We are having some value. You are getting. You are having some distance value d0, and accordingly you are having an amplitude response at DC frequency. Then slowly, when you are coming towards this resonating frequency omega naught, your amplitude response, it is increasing, right? Now after this resonating point, the distance value of to the frequency from the pole, it is again starting increasing. So 1 by d factor, it is decreasing. So if you see the amplitude response, it is decreasing. Are you getting my point? Similarly, if you look into the phase response, the phase response, it varies from 0 to minus pi. Okay, it will vary into 0 to minus pi. And why it would be 0 to minus pi? Because we are active only in the zero, in the region of 0 to pi. Okay, because if you remember the phase the responses, we are mainly active in the region of 0 to pi. And if you look this pole, there will be a minus term. So your value would be, the phase angle value for a single pole filter, it would be varying in the range of 0 to pi. And this is what it is being shown over here, that for a pole, you will be having the frequency response in the negative region. So if I compare the effect of the pole on the amplitude response and the phase response and compare it with the zeros, the effect of zeros on the amplitude response and the phase response, what we see? First of all, we need to remember this HS is directly proportional to the radius. In the previous case, HS, it was directly proportional to 1 by the distance. Over here, it is directly proportional. So, what would be the effect? It would be the, what would be the distance? It would accordingly affect the response. Okay. Here also, if you see, if I place one zero, I have to place another zero in the at the conjugate coordinates. Okay. However, we can neglect the response due to the conjugate coordinate due to the reason which I have told you before. Okay. Now let us look into the first thing. What is happening? What is the effect of this zero on the frequency response? Let us take a similar thing. Sorry. Say we are having R0 at frequency 0. We are having some amplitude. Okay. Then we are having R1. What is happening? The distance is decreasing. So it is decreasing. R2, it has further decreased. And when it has come to omega naught, which is the resonating frequency, it has become the smallest. It has become the smallest. Okay. Again, when you go on increasing, to the higher frequencies, the distance it is increasing, and hence the amplitude value decreases. Okay. So if you see, if you place a pole near to the frequency axis, your amplitude would increase. And if you place a zero towards the frequency axis, your amplitude response will be decreasing. Okay. And over here, in the phase response, the phase will be having values in the region of 0 to pi. Okay. Now there is one beautiful question. What happens if I place this pole onto the frequency axis, say onto the j omega naught axis? So what would happen if I place the pole onto the j omega naught axis? What would happen? Can anyone tell me?
The signal around what?
Modulus is finite, means.
Modulus is finite.
Means it follows the same value.
I didn't get you. So if pole is there and if I put it on the j omega naught axis, so what would happen?
Modulus is infinite because the distance is a zero.
So you are absolutely correct. So if I place this pole over here onto the j omega naught axis, so what would happen? Modulus of HS, which is directly proportional 1 to 1 by d, so this distance, it would become 0. And if this becomes 0, 1 by 0, what it is? It is infinite. Okay. However, except this point, wherever we have put the system, at all other points, we will be having some definite values. In this region and the upper region, we will be having definite values. Okay. And due to the definite values, we will be getting some definite modulus HS values. Okay. So what it is becoming, that at a particular frequency, it is becoming unstable, because we have discussed about Bebo stability. Okay. So at a particular frequency, it is become unstable, whereas at all other frequencies, we are getting some definite values. That means we will be getting some bounded output, right? So in those cases, what would happen is that such a system would become marginally stable system. Okay. And previously we have also discussed that we can only place poles on the left hand side to design realizable filters. Okay, to design realizable filter. On the contrary, if you place the zero onto the j omega naught axis, what would happen? Modulus of HS at that point, it would become zero, because the distance becomes zero and the system would still remain stable. Okay. And we can place this zero on either side of the imaginary axis, or even on the imaginary axis. Okay. So this is how a pole and a zero may affect the response of a system. Another important thing, what happens if you move the position of the poles and the zeros in a linear direction, in a horizontally in a linear direction? Okay, so suppose you are having d0, then you place d1, then you place d2. So in a horizontally linear direction, if you place the poles or the zeros, what would happen? Excuse me. In this case, if you see the distance from the j omega naught point, it is increasing over here and over here also. So the effect of the, what would be the effect of the pole? Modulus of HS 1 by d2. d2 is larger, so HS would become small. So this peak value, it would also be flatter, quite flatter, right? Whereas if you take the zero towards the EM, so say R0, R1 and R2, so if you go towards the R2, modulus of HS, it would be equal to R2. That means this suppression value, it will be moving towards the upper side, and it would be somewhere, say, on the peak would be on the something like this. Okay. So in both the cases, if you see, what is the role of the pole? The role of the pole is to increase the gain. Okay. And what is the role of the zero? It is to decrease the gain. Okay. Role of the pole is to increase the gain. Role of the zero is to increase the decrease the gain. Okay. Now, as we are moving away from this frequency axis in both the cases, the activity of the pole and the activity of the zero it is getting minimized. So as you go away from the imaginary axis, or which is basically the frequency axis, your activity of the pole and the zero will come down significantly. Okay. I hope it is clear to all of you. Good. Now there is a concept which is regarded as the rubber membrane concept, and this concept, it is mainly applied in the Z transform. Okay. And this method, it is basically a qualitative method to analyze how a filter would behave. How a filter would behave. Please be reminded, it is only a qualitative method. It is only a qualitative method. It is not a quantitative method. So, suppose you are trying to design anything, then you have to keep in mind that during the designing, you can try to use or visualize this rubber membrane concept to have an understanding how a filter or a system may behave when you have designed the system. It is only for that purpose. Okay. For this, for the understanding of this rubber membrane concept, as I told you that it has mainly been reported in the Z transform, but it is also applicable in the this Laplace transform. Okay, so let us understand how the rubber membrane concept, it can help us in understanding what would be the effect of the pole or a zero in a, what you call, or a zero while we are designing a filter. So let us take an example of a single pole. Okay. So suppose we are having this pole, over here, okay, in the S plane. So this is the S plane. Now consider this plane as a table. Okay. So this black mark area, it is the table, and over that we have put a rubber membrane. Are you getting my point? Now, from the bottom, you are looking into this interface. Okay. Next, what you have done, within this membrane, so this is your table, so this is your table front. Within this membrane, you have inserted one stick, which we call as a pole, okay? Which we call as a pole. Now, if you see the positioning of the pole at a particular distance, it is away from this imaginary axis. So what this pole has done? So this is the some point, and then over here you have the origin or the j omega axis. We have the j omega axis. Right, somewhere over here. Now what this pole has done, when we have put this pole, what it is basically, see, it is appearing just like a cone, right? It is appearing just like a cone. It would appear similar to this, However, we are just looking into the cross section and area. So we are looking over here. Now, from our previous interactions, where we are interested? We are interested on the J omega axis. We are interested on the J omega axis. Okay. So at this point, suppose I have taken the slice from here, at this point where we are having the J omega axis, we are having whatever is the amplitude over here, say a resonating frequency, say for example, say AR. Okay, so we are having an amplitude of AR. Okay, so what we are looking into at a frequency j omega, at the frequency omega j omega, whatever is the elevation of this cone, of this rubber cone, we would be taking that as the amplitude response. Okay. Now, if you see over here, if we have this kind of activity over here, if you see, we have a frequency 0. So we have, say, omega 1 below and omega 2 here. So when you look from this side, from the right hand side, you would be looking into a figure something like this, where you have a plane which has been, a portion which has been cut off, and you have the rest of the solid block cone. Okay, now if you try to linearize it, so what you will be getting, you will be initially getting omega 1, because omega 1, it starts from here, omega 1, then 0 is the frequency, this real axis, and omega 2, this is the thing. Now what is it, if we neglect the negative half of the frequency, because we usually deal with the positive half of the frequency. So if you see, what is this? This is nothing but a low pass filter. So just by placing a pole near to the origin, what you have done? You have designed a low pass filter. Are you getting my point? In a similar manner, what we can do is that we can also design high pass filter, we can design band pass filter, we can design band reject or band stop filter, then notch filter. Okay, so for designing this high pass filter, what you have to do, at higher frequency you need to place the pole. Okay, so at higher frequencies, you will be having this response something like this. So higher frequencies, it will be allowing the thing. Now, if you have to increase the cutoff just near to this frequency, this axis, wherever you want the omega c, you put a zero. So it will drastically bring down the frequency response over here. Now, how it is so? You can say, sir, how you are telling that it would happen like something like this? It is because, suppose we consider this cone again, okay? Somewhere, if we put a boat pin, you have seen the boat pin, all of you, I suppose. So it looks something like this, right? So let us take this boat pin as a symbol for zero. Because when we will be pinning it onto the rubber membrane, what it will do? It will bring down this amplitude responses to the zero. So if I say pin it over here, so what would be my this cone look like? It would look like something like this. It will come over here, and then due to the extension at the other ends also, there would be some bulging at this region. Okay, but if you see the rate of fall of this amplitude when we are putting the pin, it is much higher. Similarly, over here, if we put a boat pin or the zero near to the frequency axis, just in the frequency axis, just below the omega c, the cutoff frequency, it will significantly bring down the amplitude response of the filter in that region. And in a high pass filter, what do you need? You need that thing, because at any frequencies lower to omega c, you should get, ideally you should get zero gain. However, in realistic condition, it may be something like this. You may have a very small response like thing, okay, which are called as ripples. So in this way, you can design the high pass filter. Then what happens in the band pass filter? In the band pass filter, you place two poles, and outside these two poles, you put some zeros. So that will help you in designing. So it would be something like this. You have a pole over here, you have a pole over here, which are due to omega c1 and then omega c2, and then you place two zeros just near to the omega c1 and 2. So in this way you can design the band pass filter. What would be the amplitude response? It would be something like this, right? So this would be the band pass filter. In band reject filter, what would happen? Similar to this, but you need to stop the frequency components within these frequency bands. So we'll be having something like this, right? So this omega c1, it will allow the low pass frequency to pass through, and omega c2, first pole, say p1, it will allow the low pass frequency to pass through, and p2, it would allow the high pass frequencies to pass through. And these zeros, it will help us in suppressing the gain within that region. Okay, so this is a band reject filter or band stop filter. Now you have designed a band pass filter. Okay, now you have to design a notch filter. What is a notch filter? In the notch filter, we will be using another zero. So what happens over there now? We have discussed that in band pass filter, we are having something like this. So we have a band pass filter like this, and then we apply a zero in between where we want the notch frequency. Okay. So what is a notch filter? Notch filter, it is basically a filter which would reject a single frequency. Okay. Basically, you can say this notch filter, it is a special kind of band reject filter. In the band reject filter, a certain frequency band in the region of omega c1 and omega c2, they are rejected. So a group of frequencies are being eliminated in the band reject or the band stop filter, whereas in the notch filter, only a single frequency component it would be eliminated. I hope you have understood this point, up to this point. Anyone who is having any questions, they may ask. No? Okay, good. So another way of designing this band pass filter, if you see, you have a pole and two zeros. In this way also, you can design this band pass filter. So this is a single pole band pass filter. So, and as the as per the criteria, if you see, if you are having, we have to have poles which are greater in number than the number of the zeros. So when you are doing like this, you have to keep in mind that at the same point you should place two poles. Okay, so this is how the rubber membrane concept, it helps you in the understanding of the designing of the filters, what type of filter you would like to design, where you would be placing the poles, where you would be placing the zeros, and so on. Okay, do you have any questions up to this? Just a minute. Hello. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. ওটা চলছে। হ্যাঁ হ্যাঁ আজকে আছে। হ্যাঁ 27 তো আছে। ওকে। দাও 5 মিনিট দাও এসে ক্লাস। ক্লাস চলছে 5 মিনিট। ঠিক আছে। Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes,
yes,
sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, you are audible.
So, is it clear to all of you? So, I'm moving forward. Anyway, so in many cases, you will find the designing of low pass filter and high pass filter, it is the simplest way to design the filter. To design the other types of filters, and this low pass filter and the high pass filter you can easily design, and then what we can do is that we can use these constructed filters to develop other types of filter like the band pass filter and the band reject filter. One of the common example of designing the band pass filter is you pass the signal through a low pass filter and then through a high pass filter to get the YN. Now, over here, you have to keep in mind that the cutoff frequency of the low pass filter should be greater than the cutoff frequency of the high pass frequency. So, if you see in the first case, we have a low pass filter like this, which is having omega LPF, it is greater than the omega HPF. Okay. So only when this condition is met, then only you will be able to get the band pass filter. Otherwise, what will happen? Suppose your omega LPF, it is lower than this thing, and your LPF is the first component, then you are getting this frequency component. But when the signal is coming towards the high pass component, you are in this region, but you have already eliminated this region using the low pass filter. And while designing this high pass filter, what you are doing? You are eliminating the low pass component also. So what will be at your output? You will be getting no signals. Okay. Similarly, suppose if you place the high pass filter initially over here, so you have got this high pass filter components and you have rejected the low pass filter low pass frequency components. Now when you apply the low pass filter, you are rejecting the high pass components also, high frequency components, right? Again, there will be no signals. So what you get over here is that you can design band pass filter by cascading low pass filter and high pass filter, but you have to keep in mind that the cutoff frequency of the low pass filter should be greater than the cutoff frequency of the high pass filter. Then only you can use this cascade method to design a band pass filter. Now, this condition, low pass filter less than cutoff frequency of the low pass filter is less than cutoff frequency of the high pass filter. This condition, it is used in band reject filter. In this case, what is happening? You are sending the signal individually to each of the components. So see, omega LPF is here and omega HPF is there. So in the first instance, you are getting omega in LPF. In the second instance, you are getting the thing. And then when you are adding it up, you are getting both the components, and in between whatever the rejection band components are there, in between the omega LPF and HPF, they are being cancelled out. Okay. Now, someone may say that I want to design a band pass filter, but at a particular frequency, you may have a particular frequency needs to be eliminated. Say for example, 50 Hertz power line. Okay. So in that case, we can design the band pass filter easily, and then we can try to incorporate one zero into the system, which will help us in blocking the single particular frequency. Okay. With this, I will stop over here.